Welcome to the Weatherfield Tram. We're trundling our way through some of Britain's most famous territory. And Roy Cropper, you're just the man, because you know the route and you can tell me the best stop for the Rovers, please.
Ah, well, if you get off at Bessie Street School, you'll find a very nice scenic shortcut over the Red Wreck. On the other hand, if you go two stops further down to Inkerman Street, you'll find yourself just 157 yards exactly from the Rover's return.
Right.
I know that because Hayley and I paced it out just the other night.
Good, that's the one I'll take.
If you need a bit of sustenance, pop into the cafe, try the all-day breakfast.
Yeah, I've heard it's recommended.
You get three different types of egg, you see. You can get your fried egg, you get your scrambled egg, you get your poached egg.
All royals is my stop coming up.
That's four types of egg. Or an omelette, that's five. What, there's no need to book. I'll expect you.
The woman whose name is on this book first appeared in Coronation Street at a bit of a do at the Rover's return when she was a teenager. In the 26 years since then, she's had more than her share of heartache and pain. Her anguish made headlines on the news at 10 and even provoked a statement from number 10. Downing Street, that is. As a pioneer of Corrie, she's pulled pints at the Rovers. She's worked at the corner shop for Alf Roberts. She even served as a Weatherfield councillor for a while. 5 years ago, she had her own real-life drama when she fought and beat serious illness. Right now, she's settled into a booth in the Rovers, and I'm going to try and scrounge a drink.
I saw her stealing pants and putting them in her bag. I think she was just making sure I didn't tell Mike Baldwin.
Well, you have to.
No, I'm not so sure. I mean, Michael caught on soon enough. But if Jackie thinks it's Deirdre's fault, life would get very unpleasant for her. Same again?
Yeah, make it a double.
Or you could make it a treble, I suppose. And then I'd be able to say, Deirdre Rashid and Kirk Bride, tonight, this is your life.
I'm completely overwhelmed. I don't know what to say. I'm just...
Well, you better have that treble, I think.
Yeah, I better have something.
Actually, we'll cancel the drinks here because it's all round to our place to tell the story. All right with you?
Yeah. I have to be honest, I'm dreaming here. It's so bizarre.
Right, well, you're sitting way up. Right. Thank you very much indeed.
How about that, Michael?
I'll take you away. Well, in off the street for you tonight, a full turnout of family and friends, but your own personal co-star is missing, the man you first met at work 8 years ago when he played plumber and handyman Dave Barton.
Oh, am I glad you came in. You've had me pinned down all day.
It's nice to be welcome, one way or another.
Well, Dave Barton is not only handy, he is here, your husband, David Beckett. David, millions of us know Deirdre and her secrets, but you know the person behind those famous spectacles. Can you give us a hint of the real Anne Kirkbride?
Well, it's certainly a lot more fun living with Anne than it would be living with Deirdre. And he's got tremendous sense of humour, particularly with the one-liners. But she also gets a lot of joy out of actually not being recognised, which she can do without the glasses and if she doesn't speak. As soon as she opens her mouth, everybody knows who she is. This particular time, we're on a flight to a Greek island, and word got out that Deirdre, was on the plane. And we landed, and we went to baggage reclaim. I told Annie to go sit in the corner. I went and got the bags. And this woman came down, sat down next to Annie, had a look around. I haven't seen Deirdre yet, have you?
Yes.
Just get quiet.
Well, Anne Kirkbride, this is your life. You joined Coronation Street as an 18-year-old. Your character has matured with the serial and become a national institution. As Deirdre Anne Rashid, née Hunt, previously Langton and later Barlow, you've been married three times and made a widow. You've contemplated suicide, languished in prison, and your love life has sometimes been as steamy as one of Betty's hot pots. In the University of Hard Knocks, Deirdre has graduated with a PhD in heartache. Sounds like a song by Tammy Wynette. Let's get out of the scrap.
I bet you're both glad that's over.
I enjoyed every minute of it.
Oh, I couldn't stop shaking.
Chattiness to your bow.
Thank you, Hope.
May all your troubles be little ones.
Can't they do anything right?
You're ending our marriage, you're breaking up this family just to go to your mother's. I mean, what does that solve?
It gets me out of here, doesn't it? It gets me away from you.
Ah.
Goodbye, Angel. Thank you.
Have you anything to say?
I didn't do any of it.
Right. Take the defendant down with you.
I told you I'd get you out, didn't I? I promise.
Oh, I can never repay you for everything you've done for me. Everything everybody's done. Thanks, Ken.
And here, of course, your friends and ours from Coronation Street. First, let me thank David Nielsen for the expert guidance this afternoon. Now, Brian Mosley, Alf Roberts gave Deirdre a job in the corner shop. What sort of reference would you give to Anne?
Well, firstly, I think anybody who runs a corner shop, above all, has got to have a sense of humour. And Anne's got that in abundance. We've had more laughs together in the most traumatic scenes. I remember once she came back from America and she was quite heavily, what's it called?
Jet-lagged.
Jet-lagged, that's the word. Well, it made a change. But she should have called me Mr. Roberts, because we have a garage. And she called me Mr. Alf. Well, you can imagine the confusion. Anyway, we laughed about it.
I said, now look, Mr. Alf, and then burst into tears.
That's right. We've done nothing but laugh the whole time we've been together. And it's been wonderful, 26 years. And I respect her professionalism, I respect her courage. Respect her beauty. I think she's a great actress, and I love her. And just thank you, Annie, for all those years together.
Oh, darling. Thank you.
should give you the book right now, but there's more. On screen and off, one particular member of the Corrie cast is right up your street. You've been best friends since you first met on set 9 years ago. Took her away from the street to new life in Buckinghamshire. But she's here tonight, direct from Milton Keynes, Beverly Callard.
Oh.
Hit it off at once.
We did instantly. I started on Coronation Street 9 years ago and I was absolutely terrified. And this girl came up to me, made me laugh, started chatting to me, and I just saw those huge warm eyes and I thought, this is it. She is a true professional. She never blows a take, ever.
Oh, I do.
She actually calls it going into Deirdre land, and that is what she does. Yeah. She is a great friend. We've been through thick and thin, haven't we?
We certainly have.
She's picked me up, I've picked her up. But one of the worst things about being away from the street is being away from you.
Oh, I love you.
Oh, I love you.
We'll party afterwards.
All right.
Thank you. Okay, Anne, here's the synopsis. You were born in the Woodfield Nursing Home, Oldham in Lancashire on June the 21st, 1954. Your late mother, Enid, was a youth club leader for 25 years, and your dad, Jack, was a painter and decorator who capitalized on his talent and became a professional cartoonist. There are the proud parents, and that's you. And here, with your Uncle Arthur and Brother John, is your father, Jack Kirkbride. Your first home was a two-up, two-down end of terrace house in Little Moor Lane in Oldham. Yours was the only house in the row with a bathroom. When you were five, the whole row was demolished. You were out at the time. And on New Year's Day, 1960, the family moved to Oban Avenue on the Durker estate. It was there, on December the 9th, 1960, at the age of six, that you were allowed to stay up and watch the first ever episode of Coronation Street. You and your little brother used to play out in the road, and John, even then, Anne had a sense of the dramatic.
Well, yeah, she's always lived in a kind of make-believe world, and I remember as a child, she once ran up the street shouting, fire, fire, get the children out. And she was so convincing, she had all the neighbours running out with buckets of water. When they realised it was just a false alarm, you know.
You really head up with me.
It's just that silly Anne Cutbright again, you know. Yes.
Well, here you are in a few dramatic poses from the family album. Uncle Arthur, one of Anne's favourite tricks was doing what she called a Margot Fontaine.
Yes, it was when she was doing the ballet lessons. And for practice, she used to shout Margot Fontaine and then hurl herself across the room and I had to catch her. We were in Littlewood Stores on a Saturday and I heard this bump at the back of me. When I looked round, its hand crumpled up on the floor. She said, I shouted Margot Fontaine, it's not a good one.
Are you still doing that, Anne?
No. I might start again, though.
Jack, 1 year on holiday in North Wales, Anne got you all worried.
That's right, she was about seven. We were at a place called Nevin. And she went missing one day. So we all turned out and searched the streets for her. I couldn't find her. And we were passing the little chapel there. And we heard her voice coming from the chapel, so we dashed in. And she was in the pulpit with the Bible open. She's reading a sermon in Welsh, imitation Welsh. You know, it sounded very realistic.
I couldn't really
actually.
Speak
I could have sworn it was Welsh.
My granny was horrified. Get her out of there.
Well, with your imagination, you must have been welcome at Durker Infants and Durker Junior Schools. In 1965, when you were 11, the family moves to New Inn Farm on the moors above Oldham, and you go to Count Hill Grammar School. Your dad has lent us some home movie footage from those carefree days.
Oh. First movie film. Yeah. I've not changed.
father's job drawing funnies for the Oldham Chronicle, the family used to go off to the annual cartoonist conventions at Butlin's holiday camps around the country.
Hi, Anne. This is you. And if you look over here, this is me with hair hanging down the back of my neck.
The family friend you first met at those cartoonist conventions, the Rembrandt of the comic strip, Bill Tidy. Winter draws on, Bill.
Ah, oh, but summer days still linger in the mind from Butlins, those happy days. I remember you. Of course, everybody watched you in the camp. You were an enterer of competitions like my daughter. And I remember you went in for everything. And then the dreadful day came when Kirkbride entered the Nubbly Knees competition. Show us your knees. Enough, enough.
I won it. I won it.
He won! He won!
She burst out. I was mortified.
I was even worse. this priceless piece of work captures the essence of Butlins.
Excellent.
This is the get back to your own Shelley flag. This was the waitress who could break the most plates at breakfast. This was particularly important. It was, when you go to the loo, be careful where you put your beer. And I think this day was the day we had peas. As you're a specs maniac like me, I thought that we could change the kids in this picture to the famous Butlins Friday. I still have one at home now.
Really? In a glass
Lovely.
Case?
Lovely.
Oh, Bill.
Thank you, Bill. The Kirkbride family is very creative. Your mother was a good artist as well, and brother John is an author. But no one had ever acted until you. Your mother could see that you had talent, and when you were 11, put your name down for the Saddleworth Junior Players. Do you remember your first part?
Yes, I think I was a flower in Alice in Wonderland. I think I was a tiger lily in Alice in Wonderland. I had about two lines, I think.
Well, nevertheless, that controlled but powerful performance helped Saddleworth win a drama competition. And at the age of 14, you joined Oldham Theatre Workshop. In November 1969, you play the lead in Alice in Wonderland. And here's another of your dad's home movies, the young Anne Kirkbride in rehearsal.
Never live this down.
You were with the Youth Workshop for 3 years, taking part in productions like Inherit the Wind and Fairy Tales of New York. And then when you were 15, you starred in a production of the controversial A Taste of Honey. Now, David Johnson, you founded the Oldham Theatre Workshop. Anne was a natural, wasn't she?
Oh, she was fantastic. The best show I've ever seen in my life. You were fabulous, darling.
Oh,
you really,
David.
Really were. And do you remember how your mum and dad had to write to the press because you were 14 and you were pregnant? Well, you're looking pregnant. And I was slated in the press and they had to write and defend me. Do you remember?
Yes, I do. Yes.
And from then onwards, you were taken on by the Oldham Rep. And you're the only actress I've ever known who's never had a day out of work because you left me on the Saturday, you went there on the Monday, you spent about 3 years there and straight into the street.
I know.
And fantastic.
I've only had two jobs.
And bless you and fantastic you always were.
Oh, thank you, David. Thank you.
Your best friend as a teenager went to college and you lost touch.
But I vividly remember your pathetic cheese and pineapple porcupine.
25 years ago, you knew her as Wilkinson, but now she's Margaret Navrotsky. Margaret, this story.
Well, Anne was really very good in the kitchen. And once we were asked to do the catering for a bachelor friend of ours. Do you remember?
Yes, I do. I do.
And it was the heyday of the cheese and pineapple porcupine. And with a brief explanation, Anne started to make one. She got a grapefruit, cut it in half, covered it in foil. She had the pineapple, she had the cheese, she had the toothpicks. Somewhere along the line, she lost the plot because the toothpicks stayed completely bare.
I forgot, I didn't know you put cheese and pineapple on them. I just put all these toothpicks in some grapefruit.
The cheese and pineapple stayed on the plate.
She got you really off your tongue.
You really didn't get the hang of it, did you?
No, I don't. Oh, God, and it is so good to
see you. Thank you, Molly.
At the age of 16, you leave school to become an assistant stage manager at Oldham Rep. Your fee, £1 a week. Your dad used to drive you to the theatre and collect you afterwards. You do more than 40 plays with Oldham Rep, everything from Pygmalion to Mother Goose. Another Oldham Rep production was Hot and Cold in All Rooms.
And I still go hot and cold at the thought of it.
It's Matthew Kelly. Oh! Matthew, you yes. noticed Anne long before you ever worked together.
I did, Michael. You see, what happened was that I was working at the Rep, and so while I was there, I got to see a production in which Anne was appearing. She was only a teenager, you know, and the minute she walked on the stage, I was in absolute awe of the woman, you know, because she was playing difficult parts. And she was sensational. You knew that there was something there. And I thought, blimey, I hope I work with her. So eventually we did this play called Hot and Cold in All Rooms. Wasn't it terrible? It was terrible.
Oh, yeah.
It was really awful. And what was worse, I was terrible in it because I was really, really nervous. And, you know, any other actress might, you know, get impatient. But, you know, Anne was fabulous with me. She helped me through it and she got me over it. And that's how you know people who have talent, because people who have talent have time to look after other people who can't get on with it so well. I'll always be grateful. Thank you.
Well said. It was in 1972 that you land your first part on television. It's for Granada TV, and it's in a play called Another Sunday and Sweet F.A. by Jack Rosenthal. Now, you're the one in the yellow bobble hat.
Come on, Albion, you've got nothing to beat!
I didn't know, you're a comedian as well.
Fly, boy.
They're all over us. You're making us look sick.
Back of it. Whose side are you on, anyway?
Well, they are.
Why are they?
Because they're a better rotten team, aren't they?
What's the score, then?
One of the stars of that footballing saga is here now, Dougie Brown.
Oh, dear. What a shock, isn't it? What a shock.
It is a shock.
You know what, Maddie? We had such a great time. Everybody says she's such a joy to work with. But the best fun we had was trying to get to stand in them high-heel boots.
Oh, yes.
And we really enjoyed it. And my son did as well. It was on the clip. That was my son. It wasn't me. Oh, yes. But like all the leading men, all Anne's leading men, I was totally, completely smitten. I mean, that lovely long hair. Oh. And your hair was quite long as well.
Yes, it was.
But having seen all the trouble that poor Ray and Mike and Ken got and poor Shamir, I got away with just losing my hair.
Enjoy your night, you're lovely. Lovely.
And can I just have one last little thing? What a good night to be a birdle on Coronation Street. They're all here.
Now, you hadn't gone unnoticed in that Rosenthal play. A Coronation Street executive had seen your audition. He was looking for a young actress with a Lancashire accent to play a girl in a scene in the Vine pub. You were asked to step in and given three lines to say.
He's got a name for the club. What Capricorn.
Yeah, I like that.
I like it too. What do you think, Deirdre?
I think it's about time somebody bought me another drink.
Oh, that's what I like about her. Dead subtle, you know. You have to watch her, you know.
Oh, you can watch me any time you like. I've always had a fatal weakness for men with curly
hair. Oh, she's off, she's off, she's off. Get him in, Howard, will you? Get him in, there's a good lad.
Two brandies and two scotches.
That's the yeah. Now, what have you got to tell me, darling?
Well...
Oh.
Now, that naughty first appearance in the street was on November the 20th, 1972. The years have transformed the quiet young secretary, Deirdre Hunt, into the independent, determined woman who is Deirdre Rashid. One of your most sensational storylines was in 1983, when you were involved in a love triangle with husband Ken Barlow and factory boss Mike Baldwin. But the final showdown, when you decided to stay with Ken, 29 million tuned in. News of your final decision was even flashed up on the electronic scoreboard at Old Trafford during a Manchester United Cup game. And this is what caused all the interest.
Can I go? Please don't say I've got to go. I'll do anything. I'll go and see Mike Baldwin. I'll tell him I'll never see him again. I'll never see him again as long as I live.
No. No, I'll tell him.
Sadly, Ken and Deirdre are no longer an item, but we do have a warm message from William Roach.
Hello, Anne. Such a long time since I saw you. I thought I'd bob in again. Well, we've had some moments, haven't we? Shouting, crying, screaming, bashing you against the door. We've had some good scenes, too. Christmas was really wretched. In fact, they were so bad, we began to think our role in life was to make everybody else's Christmas look good. And yet, the question I'm most frequently asked is, when will Ken and Deirdre get back together? Even Victoria Wood mentioned it in one of her songs. Sadly, and paradoxically, I think the answer to that is it's unlikely because it's a happy ending. Well, it would certainly be a happy ending for me, Anne. You know, I like working with you. You're a very good actress, done some great stuff. And I like our little philosophical chats in the tea room. So, well done, well deserved. Have a wonderful evening, and I'll see you very soon.
Oh.
The third party in that famous love triangle was, of course, Mike Baldwin, alias Johnny Briggs. Johnny, you've done her wrong.
Oh, no, not really. We've had some good times. I remember one evening particularly when we were filming on Oxford Road.
Yes.
And we were sitting on the bonnet of the car, yes, singing,
Christmas
waiting.
Carols.
Christmas,
yes,
carols.
Yes.
And this guy said, "Hey, Deirdre, I'll give you a better time than that Mike Baldwin." So Annie said, "Well, where are you going?" He said, "We're going dancing." She said, "Well, I'll come with you." Jumped off the car, chased him up the road, and he ran. Never came back. I'm so pleased you got this tube. Oh, you deserve it.
Thank you.
I'll tangle with you anytime.
Oh!
And one of your most devoted admirers started out as simply a fan, but has become a dear friend. You exchange Christmas cards, you send flowers on her birthday, and you visit her at home. She's now 87, but from Eastwood in Nottingham, a message from Margaret Gunn.
What a lovely surprise.
Oh.
And what an honour for me to be included in this, your special evening. I am delighted for you, because I know no one deserves it more than you. And I thank you very much for the letters, the cards, and the flowers that you sent to me, and God bless you, and also David, your loving friend, Margaret.
You first met David on the set of Coronation Street in 1990 when he played Dave Barton, the plumber who saved your daughter Tracy's life from that notorious chip pan fire. In reality, love blossomed and you and David married at the Holy Trinity Church in Saddleworth in June 1992. Robin Evans, the son of your friends Ian and Bethan Evans, is your page boy. Now, Robin, you were only six at the time, and at one stage you thought you were going to miss the big day, didn't you?
Yes, 6 weeks before the wedding I broke my arm and I was worried that I wouldn't be able to be page boy. But Annie bought me a troll and put one of the arms in a sling. You're lovely.
You're lovely. Over the years, viewers have been witness to all of Deirdre's personal problems, but there was widespread concern when the real-life illness of Anne Kirkbride was revealed. Shortly after losing your mother to cancer in 1993, you collapsed on the set of Coronation Street and found yourself battling the same disease. You're diagnosed as having a rare but treatable form, non-Hodgkin's lymphoma. You take 3 months away from the street to undergo chemotherapy. You were in the capable hands of the team at Christie Hospital in Manchester. Dr. Peter Wilkinson, you speak on behalf of that team.
Yes, well, it must be very daunting to be faced with a diagnosis of cancer, but Anne was always very positive from the outset. She had to undergo a difficult treatment which involved chemotherapy and radiotherapy. And one of the side effects, of course, is hair loss. Now, this is devastating enough, but for an actress in the public eye, must have been even worse. But she was very courageous. She never let it get her down. And last month, she had a 5-year checkup, and we were able to give her the all clear.
Earlier this year, the nation watched aghast as a momentous story unfolded at Weatherfield. On March the 28th, Deirdre's infatuation with con man John Lindsay led to her being found guilty of fraud and sent to prison for 18 months. The country is up in arms. The story captures the headlines. Even Prime Minister Tony Blair adds his voice to the Free Deirdre campaign. Well, we have tracked down the real villain and the bounder has been hauled in.
No!
Another bad penny. Your fictional daughter, dodgy pilot and love cheat John Lindsay, former fiancé Billy Walker, and Tracy Barlow, alias Owen Aronovich, Ken Farrington, and Dawn Acton.
Oh, well.
I'm surprised you dare show your face.
Yes. I'm really sorry about the trouble I caused me.
Oh, it's all right.
Good, I'm glad.
Yeah. And Ken, you were there when Anne delivered her very first line in Coronation Street.
Well, I've always thought over all these years that I was responsible for her being in it. I used to go and watch football with Harry Kershaw, the then producer at Stockport County. And when I first saw Annie, I went to him and said, oh, she's great, she's a lovely actress, she's got to be in it. But in fact, I really fancied her rotten, which is why I told her.
Dawn, like Anne, you're another graduate from an Oldham Theatre Workshop.
Yeah, I joined the cast as a very shy, quiet 11-year-old. But Annie looked after me and built up my confidence and became one of my very best friends.
Oh, darling.
And now I've got a little boy of my own and Thomas sends his love.
Oh, lovely.
Thank you very much. And through your work, your life has touched millions. Off-screen, of course, your priority has always been family and friends.
And when I needed you, Annie, you were there to help me.
Your friend for 20 years, Annie Giles Quinn. Oh, wow. So, Annie, what would you like to say?
I was going to tell him about when, remember Charlie, my son was born, he's 11 now.
Yeah.
And this is when we were being sensible, wasn't it? And
when were we sensible? The only thing that kept him quiet was me singing, I was born under a wandering star.
Yeah, and she was singing it once in the taxi, right, and she was singing it, and she got out to the cash point, and she's getting the money, and the taxi driver goes, is that Deirdre? I went, yeah. He said, what's wrong with her? I said, she's dual personality, don't tell anyone.
thought we were mad, didn't he?
But what I want to thank you most for is It's a year ago today that I was diagnosed with cancer as well, and I was so scared, I mean petrified. And you were there for me on the phone, and David, day, night. And you just make chemotherapy look so good. And you're the only one that could call me Baldy and get away with it.
Oh, darling, I was the wind beneath your wing. Yeah. I love you.
Oh. See you later.
See you later. I love you.
Thanks. Finally, the scene changes back to Weatherfield. The date, July the 7th, 1975, is your very first Coronation Street wedding. The lucky man is plumber Ray Langton.
Will you, Raymond, now take this ring and place it on the third finger of Deirdre's left hand? And say after me, I give thee this ring as a token.
I give thee this ring as a token.
Of the pledge made between us.
Of the pledge made between us.
Now, Ray Langton left the street for Holland in 1978 and has never been seen again. In reality, the actor who played your first screen husband left Britain and now lives in America. You haven't seen him for 20 years, but we tracked him down to Las Vegas. He's flown in to join the party. Neville Boswell. Neville, a word for your young bride.
Well, actually, I came to get my ring back, love.
I'm sorry, I blocked it.
That doesn't surprise me. You remember when I left the show?
Yeah.
You gave me a good luck charm.
Yeah.
It's a little four-leaf clover, a silver one, and it had some words written on it.
Dear God.
I've only worn it for 20 years and 1 month.
Oh, no.
Anyway, it says on it, bless you, rat.
Yes.
Who started out that stuff? Was it yours or me?
It was both of us. And when he left, I just had this four-leaf clover, because we'd found this patch of four-leaf clovers by the butty wagon, and I couldn't find one for you, so I had one made in silver.
Yeah,
and put, bless you, rat, on the back. And Lita, our PR lady, thought it was a misprint, and it should have said, bless you, Ray.
Yes, that's right. And he wrote up, I was reading the English papers in America about how you'd gotten poorly, and how you'd suffered a bit, and you beat it, and... So, was it last summer, the summer before, I was in Manchester for one day and I went down to see you at the studio. You weren't there, you're probably skiving off, right?
Yes.
So I left you a note, and in that note I mentioned how much I admired your strength and your determination and your great courage. And I'm just glad that I had the opportunity to say that to your face, love.
Oh, Neville.
You're a remarkable girl, Annie, and I missed you very much. This is a great tribute and you deserve every second of it.
And Kirk Bright, this is your life.
Oscar-nominated Judy Dench stars as Queen Victoria with co-star Billy Connolly in the highly acclaimed love story Mrs. Brown, next on BBC One. While an evening of comedy is just starting up on BBC Two with Reeves and Mortimer's Christmas Shooting Stars, then a Ted and Ralph special.